life situations sometimes make us to doubt God. We sometimes doubt His existence, or even doubt the truth in His Word, which is found in the Bible. And we question a lot of things that happen around us, and we make means to make ends meet or to solve the situation that we are facing at a particular time. But God says something that is amazing in the book of Jeremiah. He says we should call on Him. God has something great for you, has great things for us. He wants to show these things and tell us, and that we experience these great things, if and only if we call on Him. I'm Thembinkosi Dube. I believe this message today will bless you. Keep listening. God has something for us each and every day. And today, He has prepared good food that will give us strength. When I read this or prepared this message, actually, I was trying to go to some message and God just diverted me to this one. And it's a message that makes me to, like, you see, when you have received an offer, maybe an offer for a job or an offer for something to do, and it has been guaranteed, you know, those that fear and the shaking of the knees, that is it really true what you are saying, God? Like, you don't deserve what God has for you, or what, you don't deserve the offer. And when you get there, maybe it's a job offer, when you get there, you see them welcoming you. Is it really true? That kind of thing came unto me. Is it God, what you are saying, is it really this way? Amen. We shall read the Bible. The title of the message today is When God Restores. We will find it in the book of the title verse or verses to read is Jeremiah chapter 33. We shall read it from verse 1 to verse 9. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah a second time, while he was still shut up in the court of the guard. Thus says the Lord who made the earth, the Lord who formed it to establish it. The Lord is His name. Call to me, and I will answer. And I will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the houses of this city and the houses of the kings of Judah, that were torn down to make a defense against the siege molds and against the sword. They are coming in to fight against the children and to fill them with the dead bodies of men whom I shall strike down in my anger and my wrath. For I have hidden my face from this city because of all their evil. Behold, I will bring to it health and healing, and I will heal them and reveal to them abundance of prosperity and security. I will restore the fortunes of Judah and the fortunes of Israel and rebuild them as they were at first. I will cleanse them from all the guilt of their sin against me, and I will forgive all their guilt of their sins and rebellion against me. And this city shall be a name of joy, a praise and a glory before all the nations of the earth, who shall hear of all the good that I do for them. They shall fear and tremble because of all the good and all the prosperity I provide. I want to read from the NIV verse 3 and verse 9. Verse 3 says, call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. Verse 9. Then the city will bring me renown, joy, peace, and honor before all the nations of the earth, on earth, that hear of all the good things I do for you. And they will be in awe and will tremble at the abundance, prosperity, and peace I provide for it. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for your word today. Please, God, minister to us the way you want us to, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We are reading here about Israel that was in a difficult situation. The first thing that we note is that in the time they were in Babylon, God provided Jeremiah, who was their prophet. He was the one who was there to give them what the Lord, or to tell them what the Lord was saying. So in this particular time, Israel is in a difficult situation again. So God speaks to Jeremiah in a time when Jeremiah was in prison or in an open court. In some verses they speak like that. He was in a court, or in a cell, but he was not free, confined. If you read and understand it, what had put him there, he had been put there because he spoke the truth to the king. I think it's Zedekiah, when he spoke the truth about what God was saying. It was a better place because now he was given a slice of bread each and every day. Remember, this is a prophet of God. He was from an enclosed cell where he could not do anything. And then when he appealed to the king, he said, okay, I hear what you say, but now you just also put him in court again, but in a better place, I'll say. He was given a slice of bread in the courtyard. Now, this is a whole prophet of God who delivers messages from the Lord, and God speaks through him to Israel. Right messages he conveys to Israel, but because he speaks the truth, he was taken to the courtyard. But that's just a passing by or a background of the situation. But what we learn just briefly from Jeremiah's situation is that despite whatever you go through as a Christian, you should remain faithful to do what God says. He remained faithful to tell Israel exactly the words of God. We are always tempted whenever there are challenges, whenever everybody is saying this, we tend to follow them. Remember, there were different prophets who came and prophesied to Israel, telling them the good that was there. But it was not from the Lord. It was just the devil deceiving them. But Jeremiah maintained to speak the truth. So as Christians, we will also be persecuted. Now, the first thing that we learn is that Isaiah says, this is what the Lord, God wants to bring them hope. In a time where everything is down, they are down, Israel. Maybe they even now doubt that God actually even spoke to their forefathers that he would give them a land of promise and they will live a good life. They were doubting that because of the situation they were in. Then God comes through his man who is in prison in a courtyard and says, tell them this is what I'm saying. God says, call on me. Call unto the Lord. Call to me and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. If you read the verse before, it's clear that it is God who is saying these words. You have to know that. Now he says, call unto me. You have to call on the Lord. When you call on someone, you call on the person because you need that person to assist you. But we also want the person to be involved in whatever is happening. If you read Jeremiah 29 verse 12, the Bible says, then you will call me and come and pray to me and I will hear you. Now, when we call on the name of the Lord and we invite him, you call on God, inviting him to the situation, we are explaining to him whatever you are going through. He says he will come in. It happens in our lives that we fail to engage God or to call on the name of the Lord. We look for other names that we can call to. And when we call on those names, we expect them to answer us. Sometimes we try to find our answers from the prophets. We try to find the answers from the pastors. We try to find the answers from books, from research, from everything, because that's where we think our help comes from. But this is not what God is saying. He says, call unto me because I'm the rightful person to give you. I'm the rightful God to give you the answer. Call unto me. I have good things for you. These things are so great. They are unsearchable. They are so great. You have to call on me and I have them, these things for you. It's just like a child who is not aware what the parent has for him or her. She thinks all that is there is enough, but the parent has more. So God has great things for you. As you are, God has great things for you. However, They are things that we try. If you read the verse 4 and 5, you get to understand that this Israel had tried something to save themselves. The Bible talks about their houses that they had. These were houses that they had. If we go to the history or what was happening at that time, Israel was under attack, or Jerusalem was under attack from Nebuchadnezzar the king. You know, in the olden days, to capture a city, they would lay siege around the city, and they will just keep on tightening and tightening, and those who are inside have to protect themselves. So we learn that it took Jerusalem 11 years for Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians to conquer Israel or Jerusalem. It has been 11 years, and on the fourth year, they were able to strike and the wall was broken. So during the 11 years, Israel did everything they could to protect themselves, which was taking whatever materials that was there in their house or in their house, in the temple, just to protect themselves from the attackers, which were the Babylonians. How many times do we try to cover up, to stop things that are attacking us? We use different methods. We try to use medicine. We try to use whatever you think can work for you. And it became exhausted. It could not work. And finally, the wall was broken. At times in our lives, when we face difficult situations, we try to get means even before we call on the Lord. We forget about calling God and use whatever we can use to solve the situation. We should learn to call on God so He can give us answers and tell us great and unsearchable things. God says, you will do whatever you are doing and think it will work for you, but it won't work for you because I will allow them to come inside and conquer you as Jerusalem, my city. So God allowed it. It was not a mistake. So we need to call on God and He shall answer. When we call on Him, He shall answer and give us a solution. He will also deliver us. If you read Psalms 50, verse 15, it says, call on me in the day of trouble and I will deliver you and you will honor me. When God delivers you, you will honor Him. Now, if you read again Psalms 91, verse 15, it says, He shall call on me and I will answer and I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. The last one that I got on this one is that Psalms 145:18, the Lord is near to those who call on Him, to all who call on Him in truth. So when we call on the Lord, when we call on God, He hears whatever we are saying and He wants to answer and He wants to tell us the great things. How do we call on the Lord? We call on the Lord through prayer. That's the first one. God, we call Him. But our prayer should not be the fake one. It should be true. That's why Psalms 145:18 says, to all who call on Him in truth. Our calling to God has to be in truth. Call on God with the heart of allowing Him to deal with the situation, with the heart of opening up to Him to step in the situation. Just like Israel, they first thought they could sort the situation and things got worse. It is very, very wise that you let God be part of whatever you are doing at first and let Him control the situation. Furthermore, we call on the Lord by reading the Word of God and applying it in our life. As we apply it, as whatever the Word says we do, we are still calling on God. If our lives illuminate and is filled with the Holy Spirit revealing God, we are there showing that we are calling on the Lord name, on the Lord's name. So God assures that He will hear and answer us whatever we are praying for. Amen. Now, this is like He's now telling the secret things that He has for Israel. This is the amazing part. When I read it, I was amazed. Because Israel, during the time of siege, they were actually living a hard life. There was actually even no food at some point in time. There was hunger in the city of Jerusalem. So when God says, now I step in when you call me, He says the first thing that He will bring is health and healing. Definitely, when people starve, they lose their health. So God, the first thing that He knew that they had to recap or have is health. God, the first thing that he does, he brings health and then healing, healing in the spirit and healing in the body. When God comes into your life and you have invited him, now, God, I need you in this thing. You've called on him and he answers. He will first heal your soul. He will heal you and bring life to you, bring health unto you so you can live. God knows that as people, as we get stressed, we tend to lose our health. There are diseases associated with stress, BP, blood pressure, high blood pressure, there's sugar, diabetes, and all, there's so many, many depression and stuff like that. But when God steps in, the first thing he brings to you is health. Have you ever been in a situation in your life where you are so frustrated about something or so stressed and you feel like things are not working for you? We are so stressed and you call on the name of the Lord. I don't know what prayer does, but it brings a breeze into your spirit. It's like everything has been sorted. And when that happens, you feel the blood pressure in your body normalizing. You feel the normal you in your mindset. God is restoring your health and he wants to attend to your situation. So we need to call on the Lord. The other thing that God is saying, when he calls on them, he will let them enjoy the abundant peace and security. Remember that he has already cleansed them from all their sins. But now he also says, I will give you abundant peace. Now, the most interesting part, which is amazing, is that God says, I will heal you from a sin. We know that when we call on his name, if you confess our sins, that's 1 John 1:9. If you confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So God has promised forgiveness. So he heals them and forgives them from all their sins. There is nothing as interesting or as good, a good feeling like knowing that you have been forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. I remember as young boys, one time with my brother, we were from Sunday school. The Sunday school teacher that day had said, those who want to accept Jesus Christ, let them raise their hands. And we did that. And we were so happy and so excited and we felt so light. Young as we were, maybe 10 years, we were so light. As we went home, I remember we said, we don't even mind even if we can die. We are ready to die. Why, as young as we are, why we are feeling the joy of being saved, the joy of our sins forgiven. Like everything can come to an end. I know I will meet my God or my master. So we were so excited about that. So if we confess our sins to God, he's able to forgive us. And as the east is from the west, he removes our transgressions. That's Psalms 103 verse 12. So God restores the people. Now his restoration is not just a restoration. This is the interesting part that made me to shake and get amazed that if you call on God, when he intervenes and he sorts the situation, it is not going to be a hidden thing. It is going to be something that will be open and everybody will see. I know this is one of the things that we, the evangelicals, claim to be, that this is the gospel of the Pentecostals or the gospel of prosperity. But God is saying this in his word, that when he restores, the first thing is that whatever we'll do, it will be known. His name will be known for the goodness. People will see that this is how good God is. So when God restores you from whatever is pressing you down, you might have tried everything like Israel had. But when he steps in and he answers, now he wants to give you the great things that you didn't know because he has something great for you. And when he does the great things, people will see it. The Bible even says they will be in awe. That means it's like someone who is actually surprised and even open up the mouth like that. That's the Lord working on that. That's what God has for us, if and only if we call on him. So as whatever you are going through in your life, which is hurting you, bringing you down, and sometimes making you to forget even God and even doubt the word of God, God is saying to us today, let us call on him. He is ready and he's listening. He's just waiting for you to call on him. Call on him. He will step into your marriage. He will step into your finances. He will step into your business. He will step into your career. We made a prayer. I like that prayer point that let us pray that whatever you learned, let it be working. Let it work. Not to be an accountant and find yourself a driver of a combi, or you are a doctor, but you are not doing that. Or sometimes you are at home just baking, molding blocks, just to make ends meet. Let whatever you learned, whatever we pursue before, like a qualification, let it work in the right place. So when God restores and God intervenes in our lives, he does something great. And people will see it. Nations, the Bible says, the city will bring me renowned joy, peace, and honor before all the nations on earth that hear of all the good things I do for it. The Bible talks about nations. It is all the nations. People will see when God intervenes in your life. Let just call on his name. And they will be in awe and will tremble at the abundance, prosperity, and peace I will provide. Now, what is it that God wants from us as human beings? If he's saying, let us call on him, and he promises so good things. So it's like he's saying to us, I've got good things for you, but you don't want to involve me. You don't want to call me into your situations. You just want to try on your own, and whatever you try will not work. Even if it works, it's not the great thing that I have for you. It is just a thing. It's like you're getting 10% of what you should get. So God has the best for us. Let us call on him. Let us involve him. Let us pray to him and trust that he will step in. And when he steps in, people will see. So God, whatever you are now, maybe you are crashing in your life, things are not working. I came to realize as I read this word that God, his desire is that I get the great things he has for me. I can feel like life is coming to an end. It's like I'm getting closer to 60 and things are actually not really working or shaping the way I want to. And God said to me, call on me. I have great things for you. You might be 60, you might be a retired person or whatever age, even young. God says, call unto me. I have got great things for you. And when you have called unto him and he intervenes, it will be something that will be known. People will see that that is what the Lord can do. If he can remove somebody who is unemployed or somebody who is actually having a problem in his marriage, on her marriage or his marriage, somebody who has a problem in a business, and he turns the situation around, I rather serve this God. Yeah. But the problem is we fail to involve God and we fail to trust him. Calling on God involves 100% trust. You can't call someone you don't trust. You have to trust God and let things be on him. Here, I want to say that we are not talking about people who help God. If I'm talking about people who help God, if I can come to the issue of business, people who get tenders, who get jobs through connections or through to bribes, don't call yourself or think that is God at work. It doesn't work that way. God works on a transparent ground. When God makes you prosper or makes you your things to work, they will try to sniff behind, what is it? How is he doing it? And when they find that there's nothing, they try to look around. How much did they give him? How much did he pay this one for this? Did he pay the tax? Or, because they will always follow that. But they will find that there is absolutely nothing. You are clean. It is only God at work. So I'm encouraging you today. Call on God and put your trust in him alone. And in that, he will see that and intervene and you will solve your situation. Amen. Now, if we come to the last part of the sermon, which is the application, you might have lost your job, your marriage, your health, joy, even joy, you can lose it. Your home and anything that is of value to you. You may even have given up on God and even on His promises. God is calling us and encouraging us to invite Him into our situations, and He will hear and change that. When we call on Him, we should not try to assist Him. Let Him act. He is a God. He is God. He does not need our efforts or connections that let me do. Like we said in the prayer, I think the prayer today aligned to whatever we're doing with the world today. That as we go, we need connections that God will do, that are beyond you. At the right time, God will open the door at the right time. You don't even have to do anything. That let me go there, maybe they will see. God will lead you there and open the doors. So let us put our trust. God is encouraging to call on Him. Now, the last part, when He answers, it will not be a secret. People will be there and will be in awe of whatever the Lord has done. They will be surprised. How God can do this, restore this marriage? He can restore the job. He can restore the joy. He can restore your account. You can still have money. He can restore your education. He can restore your joy. And people will see you. Maybe you were thin. And then you regain your body weight, whatever. It shows that you are now healthy because God has intervened. Now, I want us, as we go today, before we leave, let us call on the Lord. You have a problem that you are going through. You are trying to sort it just like Israel did. Maybe whatever it is, things aren't shaping well in your life. But God is saying, call on to me. I want us to call on the name of the Lord now. Take some time to pray. Just to call on God. You know that particular thing in your life where you need God to act. You know, maybe it's sickness. Call on God. Let's just do it here. Live. I know we can pray at home. But I wish that we could do it here and be sincere before Him. And just call on God. God, please help me in this situation. Well, that's all we had for you today. I believe God has ministered to you through His word. And now you know that God has all the best for you. Just call Him. Just call on Him. Pray to Him. Read His word. Apply it in your life. And let Him be involved in your life. And you will see a change. I trust the word has encouraged you in your faith and has brought hope into your life. God willing, let's meet next time. Goodbye.